Hello everyone. Sampling of continuous time signals is the topic of this lecture. We know that all natural signals are continuous signals. All the signals present in the physical world naturally are continuous time signals. But at the same time, we are living in the age of digital world. For that, we need digital signals. And conversion from analog into digital signal requires certain number of stages or steps. And sampling is one of them. Sampling is the most important step which is used in conversion from analog into digital signal. That is continuous time signals into digital signals. Although continuous time signals are not directly converted into digital, but converted into discrete time signals. So let's begin with the definition. Sampling. Let's define sampling. It's a conversion of continuous time signal to a discrete time signal. So what is important here? Conversion from continuous time signal into discrete time signal is done by the process called as sampling. Say, for example, conversion of sound wave. Sound wave, which is an audio signal, which is a continuous wave or continuous signal, it can be converted into a sequence of samples in the form of discrete time signal. When you want to process the sound wave or sound signal or an audio signal, then it has to be converted first of all into discrete time signal, and that is nothing but a signal in the form of sequence of samples. The sample is a value or set of values at a point in time and or in space. This is the standard definition of sample, is a value or set of values at certain point. So when we are talking about samples, we use a sampling operator or sampling function. So sampling function or sampler is a subsystem which extracts the samples from a continuous signal. It means a continuous signal is there from where samples are extracted. So in other words, we can also say that sampler converts continuous signal into samples. An ideal sampler can produce samples equivalent to the instantaneous value of continuous signal at the desired point. So when you take a continuous signal, we know that at different instantaneous values, there will be different magnitudes or amplitudes of the signal. So ideally, if we convert continuous signal into discrete time signal, the samples will be equivalent to instantaneous value of the continuous signal at the desired points. Practically, it does not happen. The original signal, once it's sampled, then converted into digital, while converting back into analog signal in the reproduction system, say in the communication, we want the signal in the audio form back. So it has to be reversed. So the original signal can be retrieved from the samples using Nyquist remit or Nyquist theorem by passing the sequence of samples through a filter called as low pass filter, or it can also be called as reconstruction filter. So how can we reconstruct? We can pass the samples into a low pass filter and we can obtain a continuous time signal. Now, see, there are images in this slide. See the first one, XAT. It's a continuous signal, an analog signal, therefore XAT. When we calculate its Fourier transform, the Fourier transform in frequency domain is extending from minus F0 to F0. This is a Fourier transform. All right, it has certain maximum amplitude and decreasing in both the side in negative as well as positive directions. So this is the actual signal, which is continuous time signal. Now, as we have discussed in previous slide, that we use some samples. So this is the sample. Sometimes we write it as a del t, train of impulses, impulse signal. So this impulse signal, when we represent in frequency domain, we get there are samples at certain frequencies, 0 fs, 2 fs, 3 fs, at different sampling frequencies, we get the samples. All right, sample. So sampling frequency is 1 upon sampling interval, where the sampling interval is the periodic time or the time taken by one sample. So what will be the discrete time signal when we apply this sampling function to this analog signal, given signal? Let us see in the time domain only. This is the time domain. See here. This is the time domain. So these samples are used for this continuous time signal. We get the signal in the form of continuous signal. So you see here, the instantaneous values of the samples are actually the instantaneous values of continuous time signal at those certain points. I believe this is very clear. At this particular point, see the instantaneous value and compare with the instantaneous value here in continuous time domain. So the instantaneous time values at certain time values or time slots must be same in continuous as well as in discrete time signal, ideally. And when we see the Fourier transform, look at the Fourier transform of the original signal. This is now located at different samples because it has been sampled now. So which are centered at FS, 2FS, and so on. So you see here, there is the Fourier term, which is extending from minus FO to FO, the beginning one. The second one is centered at FS. The third one must be centered at 2FS. The fourth one will be centered at 3FS, and so on. Similarly, in the negative direction also. So this diagram represents sampling of continuous signal, both in time domain and in frequency domain. The second diagram also represents an example of continuous signal and its conversion into discrete. Look at here, XT is a continuous time signal called as analog signal. The second one is samples, train of impulses, and this train of impulses, samples, train of simple samples or sampling function is used for this analog signal. We get the signal in the form of samples, which is represented here. Look at here, X and T, and which is popularly written as Xn. If we write T equals 1, if we write T equals 2, we can write 2n as well. But 2n can be written as again another integer K or P. So basically, this n is an integer here, whereas in Xt, T is an independent variable in time domain which accepts continuous values, whereas this n will accept only the discrete values, and therefore n is an integer here. So sampling can be done by for functions varying in space, means any signal which varies in space time or any other dimension can be sampled. Say there is a signal given as ST is a continuous signal. We want to sample it. Let the sampling be performed by measuring the value of function every t second. So we have to determine some sampling interval. So let the sampling interval be t. That is also called a sampling interval or sampling period. The sampled function is given by the sequence S and T. What we are doing, in place of small t, we are writing N T for integer values of n. The sampling frequency or sampling rate is defined as reciprocal of sampling period, that is sampling interval. So how can we represent, how can we express the dimension of sampling frequency or sampling rate? Samples per second. So look at this sampled output, which is actually the discrete time signal as ST, or we can write SNT. So as I talked about in the beginning, reconstruction. We want to reconstruct the signal from samples, and we want to again retrieve our signal into continuous form. So this is the process. Look at the diagram carefully. Continuous time signal is given. It has been converted into the form of samples, but it can be brought back, reconstructed into the original signal as a continuous time signal. The exact replica, the exact continuous signal is very difficult to obtain. There will be always loss or deviation from the actual signal. So reconstructing a signal from samples is done by interpolation algorithms. This is not Rome. This is your let us choose a pane here. So this is your from. All right. So let's again choose a pointer. So low pass filter is generally applied whose input is a sequence of direct delta functions which are modulated by sample values. When the time interval between adjacent sample is constant, the sequence of delta function is called as a direct comb. Mathematically, the modulated direct comb is equivalent to the product of comb function with ST. The fidelity of reconstruction, how good, how well we are recovering or reconstructing, is the fidelity, quality of the signal while reconstructing. So fidelity of reconstruction is a measure of effectiveness of sampling. The fidelity is reduced when the signal contains frequency components whose periodicity is smaller than two samples. Equivalently, the ratio of cycles to sample x is 1/2. In simple words, we can say that the quantity of 1/2 cycles per sample multiplied by fs samples per second, which is fs by 2 cycles per second, is known as Nyquist frequency. So what, how can we write? Sampling frequency fs can be written as twice of Nyquist frequency. Therefore, ST is usually the output of low pass filter known as anti-aliasing filter. Sometimes what we write, generally the sampling frequency fs is equal to twice of we write this one, twice of fm, and this particular rate is called as Nyquist rate. This rate is called as Nyquist rate. So if it is sampled at Nyquist rate or above, then the quality of the signal, quality of the recovery will be better. Look at here, this is the audio waveform. Waveform sampled at 22 bits per second means number of bits per second. So you see the reconstruction. When we decrease the reconstruction or reconstructed quality is not good, it is worse. When you even reduce the sampling bits, the quality, the deviation is more. So the reconstructed signal quality is poor. So it means more is the number of bits, better is the quality. And how do we get more number of bits? Obviously, your sampling frequency, see here, is the number of samples. So as the number of samples increases, the number of bits required to represent those samples will increase. So therefore, more number of bits, more number of samples per unit time, it means the sampling quality will be better and the reconstructed signal will be better one. So there is always possibility of error or distortion in the sampling process. The deviations from theoretically perfect reconstruction are called as distortion. Various types of distortions occur, such as aliasing, jitter, aperture error, etc., etc. There are different types of aperture error which are possible. So one of them, very popular, is aliasing. How do we define aliasing? Some amount of aliasing is inevitable when functions can have no frequency content above the Nyquist frequency. Remember, means when the sampling frequency or sampling rate is less than Nyquist rate. What does it mean? Means sampling frequency is less than twice of maximum frequency of message signal. So can we write it using a pen? Yes. If we write fs, see here, less than twice of fm, then this is less than the Nyquist rate and therefore there will be aliasing. So you see here, aliasing can be made arbitrarily very small by using sufficiently large order of anti-aliasing filter. So we can also use anti-aliasing filter of higher order and reduce the aliasing effect. And how do we get aliasing? Look at here. There are three spectral components. One component is band limited from minus B to B. So if this, there is an overlap, you know, overlap between the two spectral components. Think about the sampling frequency, this fs. If it is exactly twice of bandwidth or twice of this B, what will happen? These points must meet at the same point. So this will become B and this will become B. So fs will become twice of B. and that will be the perfect Nyquist rate. So in this case, FS is less than twice of B, and therefore aliasing effect is happening. It means there is an intersection between the two spectral component. This has resulted in telephonic communication as, cross distortion or crosstalk is the common form of distortion that can occur due to this aliasing effect in telephonic communication. So aperture error is the next error in sampling. Sample is obtained as a time average within a sampling region rather than just being equal to the signal value at the sampling instant. In a capacitor-based sample in hold circuit, aperture errors are introduced by multiple mechanisms. For example, the capacitor cannot instantaneously track the input signal, and capacitor cannot instantaneously be isolated from the input signal. We know that in a sample and hold circuit, the capacitor is an important element. If it does not instantaneously track the input signal, there will be deviation called as aperture error. The next one is jitter. The jitter is the deviation from precise sample timing intervals. So because of timing error occurs, that is jitter effect. Then noise, including thermal noise, thermal sensor noise, analog circuit noise, etc. So due to different noise signals, there may be error called as noise. Next one is slew rate error, slew rate limit error, which is caused by inability of ADC input value to change sufficiently rapidly. Because we use ADC, there the slew rate error may occur. Next one is quantization error. You see, this is how we do the quantization. We approximate the samples, and then you look at the difference between original signal and the quantized signal. One is the original one, blue one, and the red color one is quantized one. After converting it to discrete, the next process in the digital signal from analog to digital conversion is the quantizing process. So in quantization process, you see here the signal is deviated. So how much is deviation? Is the error, the difference between the two signal is called as quantization error. So this is due to the difference between the original and the quantized signal, quantized output. Another error, which is due to other nonlinear effects of the mapping of input voltage to the converted output value. Although the use of oversampling, even if there is oversampling, is there, so we can completely eliminate the aperture error and aliasing by shifting them out of passband, but this technique cannot be practically used above a few gigahertz. Oversampling means, let's consider sampling rate very, very high. We know that sampling rate needs to be greater than twice of FM. But can we take very, very large value of sampling rate? Yes, it's possible, but it's not practically possible. By increasing the sampling rate to very large value, will also require large bandwidth. The cost of the system will also increase. So therefore, after certain gigahertz, you can't go beyond that. This may be very expensive at much lower frequencies as well. So while oversampling can reduce quantization error and nonlinearity error also, it cannot eliminate them completely. We cannot eliminate, but we can reduce. The practical ADCs, analog to digital converters, which are used at audio frequencies, they do not exhibit aliasing, aperture error, and not limited by quantization error. Instead, analog noise dominates. So in practical ADCs, mainly the noise is a problem. Otherwise, the aliasing error, quantization error, aperture error are reduced significantly. But noise still remains in ADC because of electronic circuits and other components which are present in the ADC. At RF, radio frequency, and microwave, where oversampling is not possible, filters are expensive. At those microwave and very, very high frequencies, you have to design filter to reduce or remove the aliasing effect. So very, very expensive. Therefore, it's impractical. Aperture error, quantization error, and aliasing can be significant limitations when we use the sampling or sampling process at microwave and RF frequencies. Digital audio, let's talk about the audio sampling. How do we convert? You see here, there is an audio signal, and this audio signal has different samples of different magnitude. All these magnitude instantaneous values can be converted into suitable, can be represented using certain number of bits. So you see here, the limit which we have chosen here is from minus 127 to 127, which is 256. Therefore, to represent each sample, we need 8 bits. So therefore, we were talking about more is the number of samples, more will be the number of bits required to represent. And therefore, 8 bits are required to represent each sample. So it requires digital signals from sound reproduction. It includes ADC and DAC because we want to convert back. It requires ADC and DAC both, then storage of audio signal as well as the transmission of audio signal. So how does sampling rate affect? You see here, this is a signal, error is very large, but we increase the sampling rate, the error is less. Even we go beyond certain sampling rate, means sampling rate is further increased. You see almost same signal we are recovering. So the conclusion is when we increase the sampling rate in sampling process, means sampling process is made much, much larger than twice the maximum frequency of the signal being sampled, the error will be significantly, considerably low. Sampling rate, samples per second, for example, 48 kilohertz means 48,000 samples per second is the sampling rate. When it is necessary to capture audio, converting the entire 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz, which is the range of audio signal for human hearing, such as when recording music or many types of acoustic events, audio waveforms are generally typical sampled at 44.1 kilohertz. For CD, 48 kilohertz, 88.2 kilohertz, or 96 kilohertz are the standard sampling rates for the audio frequency. Sampling rate is higher than, as we know, the twice of maximum frequency of signal being sampled, or sometimes we call it as maximum message frequency. There is one agency, Audio Frequency Society, which has recommended 48 kilohertz sampling rate for most applications, but that gives recognition to 44.1 kilohertz per compact disc. Another consumer uses 32 kilohertz for transmission related applications, 96 kilohertz for higher bandwidth or relaxed anti-aliasing filtering. So this is a recommendation by Audio Engineering Society. Let's talk about bit depth. Audio is typically recorded at 8, 16 or 24 bits. We have seen the effect of bits. More is the sampling rate, more number of bits will be there. So that produce maximum signal to quantization noise ratio. The signal quality with respect to quantization noise. If lesser is the quantization noise, SQNR, signal to quantization noise ratio, will improve. So for pure sine wave, approximately 49.93, 98.09, 122.17 dB respectively for 8, 16 and 24 bits. So you can see very clearly when we increase the number of bits, so bit depth increases, the signal quality improves. And signal quality improves, it is indicated by increased value of signal to quantization noise ratio. Like CD compact disc quality audio uses 16 bit samples, generally the medium value. Thermal noise is a constraint, the true number of bits that can be used in quantization. Few analog systems have SNR, that is signal to noise ratio, exceeding 120 dB. So there are very fewer number of systems which can provide SNR of more than 120 dB. However, DSP operations can have very high dynamic range. Consequently, it is common to perform mixing and mastering operations in 32-bit operation and then convert to 16 and 24-bit for distribution. So when we convert a speech, as we have discussed, you see here, it can be, when we sample the speech, it will be converted into samples, and then speech signal which carry human speech can usually be sampled at much lower rate because frequency of, you know, the speech is not very high. The most phonemes, almost all the energy is contained in 100 hertz to 4 kilohertz. Though the range of audio is 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz, but most of the phonemes which are produced as speech are in the range of 100 hertz to 4 kilohertz that allows a sampling rate of 8 kilohertz. So even if we consider 4 kilohertz as a maximum frequency, the maximum sampling rate required, which is called as Nyquist rate, which will be 8 kilohertz. This is sampling rate used by nearly all telephonic systems that use the standard G.711 sampling and quantization specification. Let's talk about video sampling. Standard definition TV, like that we call as SDTV. and it uses 720 by 480 pixels. It is by NTSC 525 scanning line US standard, and 720 by 576 pixels, that is a UK PAL system of 625 scanning line for visible picture area. So these are the resolutions of in terms of number of pixels for SD TV. For high definition TV, similarly, it uses 720 pixel progressive, 1080 pixel interlaced, and 1080 pixels progressive, also known as full HD. In digital video, temporal sampling is defined as the frame rate or field rate rather than simply the pixel clock. And image sampling is also done, which is the repetition rate of sensor integration period. Since the integration period is significantly smaller than time between repetitions, the sampling frequency can be different from inverse of sampling time, 50 hertz for PAL, 60 to 1 hertz, 59.94 hertz for NTSC video. So video can also be sampled by using temporal sampling as well as the image sampling. And then we assign the number of pixel positions to the different voxels, which are in fact pixels in the video, and then they are represented using certain number of bits. Video conversion DACs operate in megahertz range, because we know video range, video signal is always in higher range. It's almost 3 megahertz for low quality composite video. In early games, 250 megahertz for more, for the highest resolution video graphic adapter output. When analog video is converted into digital, a different sampling process occurs. This time at the pixel frequency, the spatial sampling rate, along the scanning line takes place. A common pixel sampling is 13.5 megahertz for CCIR 601 and D1 video. Spatial sampling is determined by the spacing of scanning lines in raster. We know raster as a monitor. The sampling rates and the resolutions in both spatial directions are measured in units of lines per picture height. Spatial aliasing of high frequency luma or chroma video components are resulted as a Moore pattern in the video as a result of, you can say it's a kind of error. 3D sampling, the process of volume rendering is the example of 3D. So it's rendering samples as 3D grids of voxels, volume pixels, video voxels to produce 3D renderings of sliced tomographic data. You see there is a tomographic data here, ultrasound data, where you capture the entire 3D view. So 3D grid is assumed to represent a continuous region of 3D space. Volume rendering is a common method in medical imaging, X-ray computed tomography, MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, positron emission tomography called as PET. So these are the medical imaging modalities where volume rendering takes place. There we assign different voxels, the different number of bits and samples using 3D sampling. It is also used for seismic tomography and other applications or similar applications. So let's have further discussion. So oversampling means when sampling rate is much higher than twice of FM. Perfect sampling means you see exact matching is there between the two spectral component. FS is exactly equal to twice of FM. That is also called as Nyquist rate. And when it is less than Nyquist rate means when sampling frequency is less than two times maximum frequency of signal being sampled, it is called as undersampling. This is another diagram. In the first one, fixed sampling rate. Second one, more number of samples, look at here. And in the third one, lesser number of samples. So more number of samples are there. The reproduced signal will be always of better quality, but it will require more bandwidth. So it becomes more expensive as well. But there is undersampling case where bandwidth requirement will be less expensive, but it will have noise, aliasing effect, and other deviations in the signal. So the actual signal will be deviated from the received signal. So there will be error or the distortion in the reconstructed output. So this is how we have discussed, we have talked about the sampling process, which is applied to continuous time signal in this lecture. When sampling is applied to continuous time signal, we convert the signal into discrete time signal. And this is a very, very important phenomenon or a process which is used in the conversion from analog into digital. Although from conversion, a conversion from analog to digital requires 2 to 3 major steps or stages, namely sampling, quantization, and third one is encoding. But sampling is the most important among all the three stages that converts continuous time signal into discrete time signal, which is actually the signal in the form of samples. But while applying sampling, what is important is the sampling rate. Sampling rate must be kept twice of maximum frequency of message signal or signal being sampled, that is called as Nyquist rate. It can be made more, that is better, to get better quality of signal, but that requires more bandwidth and becomes expensive. But when we do at the lesser rate than the Nyquist rate, the signal quality will degrade. So there is a discussion about sampling rate, and the sampling, therefore, sampling rate, bit depth are the important factors which are discussed or taken into consideration while choosing a sampling operator or sampling function for sampling continuous time signal into discrete time signal. So that's all for this lecture. Thank you.